You know, I'm not sure if I lived 100 years that I would ever experience anything like this, to where I can look back and say that I know for a fact that God intervened and introduced me to this person. I remember last year, it was my pastor saying, you know, hey, how many of you can stand up and remember your favorite Christmas gift ever? If you can remember it, stay standing. And a lot of people stayed standing. And then he said, what was your favorite gift from last year? If you can remember that, remain standing. And you know, almost the entire congregation had to sit down. And his point was that every year we spend money sometimes that we don't have and buy people things that they don't need, and that 3 months later, they're not even going to remember. And that Christmas has gotten completely over-commercialized. Today, we're going to meet CJ. Wait until you hear CJ's story. You're not going to believe it. You're not going to believe how I had the opportunity to meet CJ and how we had the opportunity to go be a part of his very special Christmas. And I remember I was coming out of my office getting ready to head to lunch with my wife, and I caught a glimpse of Kathy Gallion, my assistant at the time, looking on the internet for various local charitable contributions. And I had this real sense of frustration come upon me when I started realizing how impersonal that was going to be. And I said, honey, I saw Kathy on the computer looking for a project, and I just don't feel right about it. And I said, I feel like, let's just pray. And we bowed our heads at lunch, and we prayed, and we said, God, if there's somebody special that has a need that we can impact and that we can help give Christmas gifts to or do a project for or meet the need, God, we just pray that you would bring them into our life. Sandy, that was the day before I met you.
Confirms that I always pray that I'll see a sign that I'm worthy or doing something right. So that's a testimony. He's with us.
We didn't really think much more about it. We prayed, we got up, we walked away. Now, days earlier, I had started a search on the internet with Craigslist.com looking for some banners, some motorcycle banners to hang in my garage.
While I was searching through the Craigslist ad, out of the blue, I saw the capital letters Yamaha.
I got there, pulled into this nice little humble townhome, and walked up, and here came Sandy. She was all smiley.
And you had told your mom, you know, gosh, Mom, you're not going to let that complete stranger in our house, are you? Isn't that right? Isn't that what you told me?
I was like, when she said, yeah, he's going to come. He's going to come over here and pick it up.
I said, go ahead, come over here. Mom, you're not.
You don't know this guy.
And I said, no. God just spoke to me and told me that this is okay. This is okay. I mean, I didn't know. And she says, you're okay. So I just went with it. I was like, And so for it to work out like it did, you know, that was a testimony to CJ. I said, see, CJ? I mean, we were just blown away. I literally was very emotional after you left that day.
We started standing there and had some small talk. And,
you know, I'd asked you, I said, hey, I noticed that you didn't really know the area that well. And I said, how long have you lived here? And then when you said 4 years, I said, now hang on, you've lived here 4 years and you don't know the area that well. There's got to be something. And then you had mentioned a trip to the hospital.
The only way I know my route back and forth to the hospitals.
Yeah.
And I said, who's we and who's going to the hospital? And I could see this unbelievable look come across her face as if she knew she was about ready to have to tell the story again. She started telling me about this incredible human being, her son, Cameron Joseph McGehee, also known as CJ, who since the age of 9 years old has battled one of the most brutal, one of the most undiagnosed, and one of the most unknown forms of cancers. And their whole life was dedicated to his survival. Their entire existence at this point in their life was about helping him fight to stay alive.
And I've always, you know, tried to protect him from everything, you know. I guess you do that with your baby, you know, that was him. I couldn't do anything about this. I couldn't do anything to stop this. And I wasn't prepared for that.
She started to explain to me that they had moved from Texas because the doctors gave up on CJ and said, we can't do anything else to help you. So Sandy began her fight And she got on the internet and looked for all the best doctors and found a place in Florida that she could come that wouldn't give up.
I sold everything we had, and I was determined there was no way I was going to just accept that my child was going to die in front of me, that there was nothing. I was going to do something. I was going to make an effort. I wasn't just going to let it take over. That's kind of like when the rug was pulled out from under me at that point, because I knew my child was born with both lungs. Well, when he came out and he said there was nothing we could do, I knew then, I said, oh, this is bad. This is really bad. You know, and that, it just kept going from one extreme to another, you know. It just kept getting worse. That's when we found out what kind of tumor it was. They had to send off for, you know, biopsies and send off that. And found out that it was around his aorta and involved all of his vessels and to the heart. It wasn't in his heart, but he pushed his heart all the way over to the opposite side. But it's just been a fight ever since. We just determined, you know, that I was going to fight it no matter what, you know.
And as I stood there and started hearing their story about all the trips back and forth to the hospital and the sleepless nights of hoping and praying and wishing and dreaming that this thing would go away and that normal life would return, it was heartbreaking. And to think about Sandy doing this all on her own, it was almost more than I could handle. And it was close to that point when I started asking about their finances and what they were going to do for Christmas, because Christmas was just a month away. Humble face. She said, Michael, she said, we're going to be okay. She said, we don't need a Christmas. We won't have any Christmas. And I said, the heck, you're not going to have a Christmas. I said, you are going to have a Christmas. What would you like for Christmas? I had a speaking engagement coming up in just a week or two after. I took a risk and I knew that I needed to tell these people about CJ's story. That I needed that kid to have a special Christmas. And you cannot believe the outpouring.
Merry Christmas, CJ!
And I had a camera bag there that day with one of my guys who was filming, and they filled it with cash. And we put together, I think it was nearly a $3,500 to a $3,700 Christmas for this kid. And I was on top of the world. I couldn't wait to go give this to him and to see.
Sometimes your calling comes in dreams. Sometimes it comes in the spirit's breeze. Yeah, you reach for the deepest hope in me and call out for the things of eternity. But I'm a man of dust and stains. You move in me, so I can't say. Failures and upset plans test my faith and leave me with empty hands. Are you not the closest when it's hardest to stand? I know that you will finish what you began. And these broken parts you redeem, become the song that I can't sing.
It was incredible to walk out of their house that Christmas day and know that God Himself had ordained this and set this all up from the beginning. I mean, He used something so inconsequential that I loved to introduce me to something that he loved and cared about and was very consequential. I'm editing some videos, and I stumbled across the footage where I was telling the story to my clients about CJ. I immediately thought, I need to stop right now and call and check on CJ. And I picked up the phone, and I called Sandy. And I could tell the minute that she answered the telephone that something was bad wrong. And that's when she told me that she lost CJ.
People ask if I, like, get mad over stuff like that. Like, when you say I don't necessarily feel sorry for myself, I don't really. But I do. Sometimes I get kind of angry, you know, because, I mean, most of the time I don't really think about, you know, why I'm here or something like that. Because if it wasn't me, then it could have been, like, somebody else. Maybe somebody else in my life.
And Sandy commenced to telling me the story about how he died, and it was incredible. He had gotten very, very skinny. The tumor had come back and it had choked off his esophagus and he was no longer able to eat. And he got to the point where he couldn't even drink water anymore. And while they were sitting there on September 15th of 2008, CJ started drumming on himself and trying to keep a beat. And all of a sudden, he started humming the music to try and let them know that he was hearing some beautiful music. And Sandy told me that when they were boys, they had this sign they would do with their hands. And that was a way of saying something was fantastic, something was awesome. And CJ started doing that right then and there. And at one point, he's looking up and he's talking to these people in the room. He looked up and put his hands up. And with his tears in his eyes, he said, "No, I said I would never give up." But his mom looked at him and held him and said, "Oh, son, you're not a quitter. You're not a quitter. You never gave up. You fought a hard fight." And she said, "Son, if God's angels are here to take you and you need to go be with God, you can go be with God." She said a few minutes later, one of his brothers was leaning over him, and he knew that the brother needed to get out of his way if he was going to go with these angels or these people that were there to take him in the room. And at that point, the brother leaned up and CJ said, "I can't stand up for you, but at least I can sit up." And he sat up in his bed while his mommy was holding him. And he looked at her and he said, "I love you, mommy." And he died.
You have led me to the sadness. I have carried this pain. On my back bruised and nearly broken, I'm crying out.
And I knew I wanted to tell you this story about this amazing kid, because he has changed my life. I finally have seen what it's like to live a worthy life and to be thankful for what you have and to endure your circumstances and your challenges, because somebody has always got it worse than me. Thank you for letting me share this story. And I pray that you'll always think about CJ the next time you're having a bad day. Allow him and his life to inspire you to reach a new level in your own life. Thank you so much. God bless you and have an amazing and a Merry Christmas.
Yeah. door.